everybody. Welcome. I'm Kim Deaton. I'm the director of the Appalachian Arts Alliance. And I'm so excited that you took time out of your Saturday to come and support the arts and support the people in our community who have worked extremely hard this week and are so out of their comfort zone to bring this show to you today. A lot of times we're working with children, and we have a lot of things to do with children, but now we're trying to branch out a little more and provide some programming for our adults in our community. I was in theater in high school, as were a lot of the people that you're going to see here, and they have the love for stage, but they haven't done it in a long time. And so being able to reintroduce people back into the stage, into the live, into the arts, has been such a wonderful experience this week, and I couldn't have done it without the help of one of my dearest friends, Ms. Octavia Biggs, with Lexington Children's Theater, Summer Shooting Stars Youth Theater.
Woo!
And she's been here for 2 weeks. She's officially a Hazardian, and I think I'm going to keep her for a while. But it's been a really interesting and fun process this week, and it's been something that I haven't even done. So I'll let her explain a little bit more to you.
So this week was kind of a creative collaboration. So what we did, I started out with a series of writing prompts on Monday, and everybody sat at tables down here, and they just started creating and writing on a daily basis. By Tuesday night, they had stories written, and Wednesday, we started staging the stories. Thursday, we had a music rehearsal. Friday, we staged the rest of the show. And today, we've done a couple of run-throughs. So I think somebody said, Sara said backstage, that we've put 20 hours into this performance today. And it's unique, and it's diverse, and it is stories that everyone has from their heart that they're sharing with all of you out here. I'm so thankful to be here with Timmy. Timmy and I worked together about 20 years ago. And when I was first getting my companies and everything started, and so this is nice that we've had a reconnection. I love your community. I love these people on stage. They poured their heart out into this production, and I am so very, very proud of them. So I hope you enjoy the show. Thank you so much for inviting me. And we give you
Appalachian Echoes.
I never planned on my own meal.
shaking as if I'm in the snow. Hurtful words pierce through my ears. My heart falls. It was time I came home. What a bright day it was in the sunshine state for someone who only seen darkness. As I pulled out of the driveway, I looked out the rearview mirror. I whispered goodbye. Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, Tennessee. It was time. I came home. Familiar roads filled with green trees mocked me. Failure. Those Kentucky mountains I tried so hard to get away from. Those roads had knew me better than I knew myself. I do not want to be here. I do not want to be here.
I can't support your dreams.
Fail.
You don't bring out the best in me.
Fail.
You're too sad.
I failed. I am home. I hate myself. Who could ever love me? Who am I anymore? I hate myself. I can't stay here. I'm not coming back here. But the days turn into weeks of sadness and darkness, and crying myself to sleep becomes the norm. But short trip to Tennessee, that's where I should be. That could be home again. But the roads, they just feel empty. They don't put me at ease. Is this home? This is in Kentucky, where the people know me and they call me by my name. And this is in Hazard, where my nephew is running around the creek, where I get to see my mother every single day. It was time I came home. And my eyes are wide open for the very first time, driving on the parkway. And those roads that knew me better than I knew myself, maybe they always knew where I was meant to be. I need to stay home. I need to come back home. It repeats over and over in my head. I am almost home. Familiar roads filled with green trees welcome me back once again. They fill me with so many emotions, happy, joyful, spiritual. I am almost home. Sign. It reads Branson Lane. And this is where I need to be. This is where I belong. Who can love me? I am loved. I can't support your dreams. I am not a failure. Even on my darkest days, those Kentucky mountains, they never stray. The Kentucky mountains have a funny way of bringing you back and giving you a piece of yourself you didn't know was missing in the first place. I found myself. I belong here. My story continues. It's far from over. But that's a story to tell for another day. Kentucky, you saved me. I am finally home. Ooh.
Hollars. So the 15-year-old gal met an older man and married him. It wasn't too much longer that she was with her first child, then a second, my father, and a third, and a fourth, a fifth and sixth, and then a seventh. But life took her right back to those Hollars. Back in those days, you farmed as much as you could. Many a tale had been told that eagles would carry her babies away if you left them unattended. So as Granny worked the gardens, she would move her baby that was on a blanket up the fields as she worked. The family lived together as a commune. Sisters would go together in pairs up to Michigan and Illinois to make some extra money at Del Monte Tiger Company, while the other sisters stayed behind to tend to everyone's children in the family, as well as the farm and business. Our family either had it hard or easy. The black-haired, red-skinned women moved rocks out of the fields, carried them up on the mountains to pile the mounds, milked the cows, and stored the milk in the cold water streams to keep it fresh. They made their own clothes, taught their children, and fixed enough food for the family and any neighbors passing through, or whoever may be helping them on the farm. When my dad was about 9 years old, he would hop on the back of their old plow horse and ride her about 10 miles across the shadow-covered mountains all by himself. He'd catch wild hogs, notch their ears, mark the family brands. He'd barricade a cow or calf in with logs and brush, pushing them back against the cliff. He would dodge the mother's goring horns, thrashing hooves, and brain-blowing kicks. He was tough. He didn't shy from a round of fisticuffs with any roustabout. He had to be tough if he wanted to make it through those tough hills and hollows. My father wanted to get out and see the world. He traveled the world, met his first wife from Japan, and had some children, and moved right back to those hollows. My tan, leather-skinned father settled back in these deep, dark mountains that he so desperately tried to run away from. He met my mother, who was also raised in a hollow. Now, like the mossy-covered mountains of rocks his family piled on the hillside, my father and his family story has been told. Or maybe it's still continuing on with his great-grandchildren, covering the same footsteps that they had strided on afar off years ago. There will be many a hank to fight, since the stock laws have changed. It may not be the same battles, but you'll battle nonetheless. I tried to leave these hollers too, for many years. But a shadow holler is where we call home and keep getting called back to. You just can't get away from the holler.
Oh, but standing on stage, looking upon the crowd of parents, children, friends, and families, all expecting something. Still, for the second you're standing there, too silent, too nervous. But deep down, you know that standing there silent isn't going to take your eyes off. It isn't going to slow your pounding heart, and it surely won't shut off those lights. Those yellow and blue lights feel as though they're betraying you everywhere. Finally, you open your mouth and begin to feel every word you rehearsed, and you see eyes of every color. Your mouth is moving faster than your brain. As you finish, a heavy weight hits your shoulders. You take one last glance at your now proud family, the rest of the crowd, and those not-so-scary lights. Once again. Hall. The word home isn't just exclusive to the house. For me, home is on a stage. When I'm on stage, I feel magic. Free. I feel like I can be myself. When I'm on stage, I can be anything and anyone. Before I speak, my heart begins to pound. The lights, the eyes, everything. Being in the spotlight is exciting, nerve-wracking, and everything in between. I look at the audience, and it gives me somewhat a sense of courage. Speaking on stage is like overcoming your worst fears. Being on stage is beautiful, and the possibilities are endless. And that's what being on stage means to me. But what does home mean to you?
He had been moved to ICU. to realize that he wasn't going to come out of it and remain. She told the hospital I was a skeletal care surrogate and let go of control. I contacted our local hospice, who came to assess Greg. They agreed to take him as a patient. I rode with him in the ambulance. When we arrived, the wheels of the bed got stuck in the ambulance and we couldn't get him out. We called the ambulance service and asked them to send help. Meanwhile, the ambulance attendant had been monitoring Greg's bottles, which were slipping. The ambulance driver said that we had to take him back to the hospital. No! I said. It took me weeks to get him out of there, and you are not taking him back. I was ready to fight. While he argued, the guy showed up from the ambulance service and was able to unlock the wheels. The nurses whisked Greg out of the ambulance and into his room. In that room, I sat there with him as he peacefully slipped out of his body. I sat there, sad and stunned. But my promise to Greg was not finished. While his mom and grandmother planned the funeral, including a freshly dug grave and a tombstone anyone would be proud of, I thought about how I was going to keep my promise to Greg to not let them bury him. His mother did agree to the cremation, but she and Granny were set on the burial. The funeral held in the shelter of the cemetery, where Greg's family, among others, were laying in rest. The cemetery sat on a hill, overlooking the community below. Greg didn't want any preaching, but again, the moms wanted. The preacher didn't talk on because he didn't know her. And I gave the eulogy, and we finished with playing John Lennon's Imagine, which Greg wanted. Then they carried the container that held his ashes to the grave and buried him there. That night, I met with his cousin and his wife, who were also friends of mine, and knew exactly what Greg wanted. At midnight, we gathered a couple of shovels and spot. The cemetery was dark and quiet around. We could only drive so far in. We exited the car, grabbed our tools, and began the journey up the hill to the grave site. A dog barked. We jumped! What if someone came out to see what was going on? We knew we had to hurry. We got to the grave. We dug, and soon Greg was out. We quickly replaced the dirt and smoothed it over and got the hell out of there. As I thought about what I could do with the ashes, I could almost hear Greg telling me exactly what I was thinking. I had some small containers that I used for casket gifts in the past. I filled several of them with this ashes and finished it with a picture of Greg on each. They were for his closest friends. Since the kids in our theater group, and a lot of people in town, that knew Greg had not been able to make it to his funeral, we decided to have a memorial service for Greg at Bobby Davis Park, where our youth group, which Greg helped found, performs in the summer. We played videos of his favorite roles and told stories about him, and everyone talked about how much they loved Greg. When the younger children had left, we scattered the remaining ashes under our stage. I had somehow managed to keep my promises to Greg and felt great about the income. But then, his cousin lets me know that Granny is upset over something about the nothing she thought the funeral home did wrong. And she wanted him dug up. Busted, I thought. But not quite. I still had the boxes the ashes were in. I also had some river rocks in my basement that I had saved, although I didn't know why, but I was glad I had. I took a hammer and I started busting those rocks out. It wasn't easy, but I finally managed to create enough polarized rock to look like human remains and put them in the box. That night at midnight, we traced up the hill. We dug where we thought we had found the box the first time and buried that box back into the grave. Again, we got the hell. I suppose the reburial of the ashes went smoothly enough because we never heard from the funeral home that there was anything amiss. Shortly after, both his mom and granny followed him to their own burial. Opened the door for me to tell this story. This is Greg. He deserves to be on this stage as well. It's his story. Thank you.
the kettles for making soap, and the stone for making peanut butter oil, the wringer washing machine, and the dinner bell. Experiencing these tangible time machines, hearing the irony of the cars outside revving and starting to the vehicles of recollection, the old barn supporting the weight of memories, the objects of people I never knew. I remember my loved ones, missing people I've never met. I remember the thankfulness for the people I still have and the ones who helped me become who I am. I remember the magic of these objects, the warm Appalachian energy they inherited from the people I love. I remember the joy they left behind for me and the necessity of the time before me. But you never know how the wind will blow.
But you never know.
Or more are gathered. I took a walk in my backyard to home. It's in these hills that home exists, where mom and dad are sitting on the porch waiting for me to come home. Home. Mom's chili and dad's catfish, and mama's sweet tea wrung out of her dark, dirty garden, worn hands. It's a home that only exists in my mind now. I took a walk in my backyard today. A walk in these very hills to connect, to remember, to gain clarity, to breathe, to be. Peace. I took a walk in my backyard today. My backyard. Your backyard. Our hills.